And welcome back to part 6 of Heart to Home Bible Study. We are so thrilled to be kicking off 2021.
Oh my.
Even though we're a couple days in.
Yes, we are.
It was still nice. We took Christmas weekend and New Year's weekend. We had Mike's favorite, Grace's favorite.
And we had a little bit of a break.
Yes, it was so nice. But it was so cute. Grace's favorites was definitely adorable.
Well, she's just adorable. I mean, what can I say?
It was cuter than Mike's favorite.
Yeah, he was stiff as a board, but that's okay.
It was a good time. But it's good to be back yes. on track. We are talking about steps to answered prayers. And this is something that in 2020, I truly feel in my heart that 2020 was a year of preparation for all of us to truly be prepared for what God has in store for us to step into our God-given talents and destiny and giving. And it's important for us to know how to pray.
And not to give up.
And not to quit. We are to walk by faith and not by sight.
Except if you watch the one lesson that Michelle shared, it was just the opposite.
I messed up.
Yes, she did.
But we are to truly walk by faith and not by sight. And even if the world, which I think everyone, no matter which side of the aisle you're on, can agree that the world has completely lost it.
Yes, they have.
But I was praying this morning. We had church, of course, this morning. And before we headed off to church, I was reminded of the scripture where Jesus says there's going to be wars and rumors of wars. There's going to be chaos.
Yes,
but in
is.
The midst of chaos, Jesus is there. He is calming our storm.
Yes, he is. And so we have, like we said, 5 steps that we've already gone over.
Yes.
We have a new one, and I think it is amazing when God does this, that it is perfect for the week that we've lived in.
Hallelujah. What a week.
I know. What a week. You know, I heard someone say it, a week that we'll never forget. But you know what? There's a lot of other stuff that's happened much bigger than this week that we have forgotten.
Yes.
But we cannot forget the promises of God.
Yes. Dad told me the other day, he said he remembers he was young and he stayed up till 3 in the morning one time during the Gulf War and watching everything on the news for that. And he
I think he was older than 3 years old.
No. Well, he watched everything. He stayed up till 3 a.m.
Oh, I thought you were saying he was 3 years old. And it was like, then I robbed the cradle.
You're just not listening to
me. No, I wasn't.
3 a.m., not 3 years old.
Okay.
And he said he can remember that, thinking the world's coming to an end. Everything is stopping. You know, my life is falling apart.
Yes.
And there's always going to be something. But what remains steadfast, it's the Word of God.
It is. So step number one was decide at what you want or what you need from God. My bracelet's making a lot of noise. Every time it does it, I'm thinking someone's not.
But it's pretty.
Well, it matches my outfit.
It matches the table runner.
Well, I didn't care about that, but it's animals. Okay, number two.
Annoying.
Yes.
Okay.
Locate the scriptures that promise, that give you the promises that you want from God.
You messed up on that one, but you weren't wearing your bracelet.
Yeah, well, so it's still there.
You can start taking your necklace off.
Little tired. Okay.
What a week.
I know. Okay. Locate the scriptures that you desire to see happen in your life from God.
That's number one.
That's number two.
That's number two. Okay, what's number three?
Number three, get the scriptures that you have found, we set a minimum of 3, firmly fixed in your heart.
Amen.
So that they come out of your heart and not off of your cell phone because you forgot what they are. Let's remember what God has said, which
Amen.
Is what I preached on this morning.
Amen.
All right, number four, ask God for what you want or what you need, and then believe that you received when you pray.
No matter what circumstances going on around you, when you say amen, there's typically, not always, but there's typically some time between the amen and there it is.
Yes.
And it's in that moment from the amen to there it is, that's called faith. That walk of faith between the amen to there it is, I see it, I possess it, I hold it, not just by faith, but actually possessing it in the natural.
And it's not a masculine term. I'm so sorry.
Yes. We do want to clarify that. Amen actually means, in the Hebrew, it means so be it.
That's right.
So be it. So a fun little fact in
right. So it's
there.
Not gendered thing.
No.
And it's kind of weird that our world has begun to change things, but I'm telling you,
so
amen means So be it. As I believe.
It means I agree. It is an absolute agreement. When you're saying amen, you are aligning yourself with the agreement of heaven.
You've got your hands open saying, okay, God, I believe.
God, I receive it. And right now, we're trying to teach Grace how to catch and throw. And in that process, I'm having to learn how to catch and throw.
We never taught her.
I'm not good at it. But it's so cute because Jessie will say, Grace, are you ready to catch it? And she goes, uh-huh. And she throws her hands up just like this. And we have to have that same childlike faith. When we say amen, we are throwing our hands up to our Father and we're saying, Father, I receive your best.
Okay, step number five. Refuse amen. To allow doubt and fear to enter your mind.
Yes.
You know, we said amen and then we're waiting for there it is.
And that time period, there's always potentially going to be a time period. I love instantaneous miracles.
I love too.
Before you even say amen, you see the healing or the provision or the breakthrough. And God can do that. He is a miraculous, instantaneous Father. But at the same time, there's some time. And sometimes we say amen, and it takes some time. So refuse to let doubt and fear creep.
Okay, so this is the one we're studying this week.
Number six.
See yourself. Mm-hmm. Believe that you will succeed and not fail.
Yes.
Isn't that amazing this week?
Yes.
Because all we have seen and supposedly the natural is failure.
Failure in every branch. It just seems like a complete circus. A friend of mine sent me a little meme or whatever, and it said, congratulations 2021, you made it 6 days. and you feel that way. It's like, we had 6 days of peace. But the thing is, in this world, you're going to have chaos, tribulation, trials, It's going to be crazy, but Jesus has come to give us life and life.
And that's why it's so important for you and I to not accept failure. So Michelle, read Romans chapter 13, verse 14. And what we're saying is, don't accept failure.
Amen.
Don't prepare for it. Don't plan for it.
Yes.
You are victorious because of Jesus.
Well, there's more for you than against
you.
And while you're turning, is it Romans 13?
Romans chapter 13, verse 14.
I was reminded last night, Jess and I were praying, and I said, Jess, how many angels fell from heaven when Lucifer, he started a rebellion, and he said one third. And I said, so that means, here's some math for you, there's two angels to that one demonic force. So there's always more for you than ever will be against you.
I like that.
And so it's good math. There's always a 2-to-1 advantage on your side. There's always more for you than against you. So Romans chapter 13 and verse 14, it says, rather clothe yourself with the Lord Jesus Christ and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the flesh. In other words, I think on these things. Paul said, think on these things that are pure, that are holy, that are kind, that are good, that are just. Get your mind out of the gutter and think on these things.
Well, King James says, make no provision for the flesh to fail.
No place.
We have no place.
Yes.
And even though our hearts may be upset, our heads may be upset, it could be that our body is sick or our finances are not where they need to be, we make no provision to fail. And we need to make certain that we receive the answer to our prayer. And we even saw that earlier. As soon as we pray, we say, Father, I've received, even though in the natural it looks like nothing changed. You know, this morning as I was preaching, I was talking about the ladies that went to prepare Jesus's body that had been put in the tomb.
Marys.
Well, you're looking at the fact that they saw in their heart total defeat.
Yes.
The man that they were following was dead.
Yes.
They crucified him and they went to the tomb and nobody was there. Well, they didn't immediately think, yee-hee! They thought,
he's gone, he's been stolen.
He's been stolen. And they began to weep. They were perplexed. Mm. They were upset, just like many of us are. But I'm telling you, angels showed up.
Hallelujah.
And the angel said, why are you looking for the living among the dead?
Wow.
And that's so good. You and I need to realize that even though we've asked and it looks like everything has died, it does not mean that God has not created a way where there seems to be no way.
Hallelujah.
And the point that I was making with this this whole thing this morning because I know you were in kids' place.
I don't get to hear her messages because I'm in kids' church.
But she gets to hear it when she edits.
When I edit, I get to just enjoy it all.
What the part was is I was stressing we need to remember what God said, no matter what.
Yes.
And the angels turned to these ladies and said, "Do you not remember what Jesus said? That he would come again. He would be risen from the dead."
Hallelujah.
And so I'm telling you, we need to remember what God said. And when we do that, we're not preparing for failure. We are preparing for victory.
Hallelujah.
So we need to eradicate, get rid of all thoughts that cause us to be troubled in our hearts.
Yes, and if you ever have that moment where you are able to pinpoint, hey, this is really getting to me. It might be social media. It might be the news. It might be a specific person. Hey, this is really getting my heart upset. This is really agitating my spirit. You have the right to say, I'm going to put that on the shelf, and I'm going to take the time that I was on my phone or in the news, and I'm going to focus it in on the Word of God. If you're constantly pulling up your bank account on your phone and you're going, oh, there's no money in my bank account, or maybe you're pulling up the doctor's report and you're pouring over it, the same time that you would pour over your bank account or the doctor's report or the natural situation in this world, take that time and pour over the Word of God.
Remember what God said.
That's
right.
And when you put into remembrance, we kicked off 2021 at the Place Church, had an incredible service.
Incredible.
And we did communion as a family. And we had the kids in there. You know, if you wanted to partake of communion, we did as a family. And it was great. It was a little cups.
It's the sanitized version.
You
have everything.
You peel back the little
which
wafer.
Which the wafer tastes horrible, but that's
it does.
Okay.
It's unleavened. And then you go to peel it back and it's like juices spilling everywhere. But it was so much fun.
It was. There was a powerful presence of God.
You're
there.
You're reminded of what Jesus did for you over 2,000 years ago. And his word, it's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore.
And in politics, economy, health reports do not change what God has said.
God's word is eternal.
But it's up to us. Turn to Isaiah chapter 26, verse 3.
I'm already there.
Because what we have to do is we have to protect our mind. That's why he said renew your mind, which I've had to do a lot. It's like I feel like putting on a football helmet. And so that when I knock myself on the wall, I'm reminded that I'm to protect it.
You technically, according to Ephesians 6, need the helmet
it
of
says,
salvation.
That's right.
So
salvation keeps me from all things.
That's
that
true.
Evil.
So when you're banging your head against the wall, it's protecting you. Okay, Isaiah chapter 26 and verse 3. It says, you will keep in perfect peace. Take the word you and just kind of...
Denise!
Michelle, I will keep in perfect peace. Those whose minds, so you say, how do I keep in perfect peace? It's telling us, those whose minds are steadfast. Why? Because they trust in the Lord.
Yes, I trust in you.
Our trust, our hope, it cannot be, and this is going to be a bold statement, it cannot be in a political party.
That's right.
It cannot be in a government.
No.
Here's another bold statement. It cannot be in a vaccine. It cannot be in a doctor. It cannot be in a financial advisor. It cannot be in your job. It cannot be in a spouse or a parent.
That's right.
Our trust is only to be found in the Lord. And when your trust is firmly fixed on the Lord, then you will have perfect peace.
But it is up to us to make certain that we deal with what's going on in our head, because we get on autopilot a lot. And I even shared that this morning, that we just love to play. It's not going to work. You're going to be in a place that you're in right now and nothing's ever going to change. God has forsaken you. Is God even real? But we need to let those thoughts... We need to let those thoughts be renewed and changed, because what we do see, we're moved by.
Yes.
And we have to only be moved by faith.
Amen.
Faith.
When we were in Bible school, they used to tell us with Dr. Savelle, Jerry Savelle's ministry, they would say, I want you to say this out loud. I am sick. I am healthy. It takes the same amount of energy, the same amount of work. But one is going to get you to a place that you don't want to be, and the other one's going to get you to where you need to be. And so maybe for this year, you are facing some sickness. You're facing some lack. You're facing some things that you know, God, I have to have you. I know that no man can change this. It takes just as much energy stand up in the morning and say, I am healthy.
That's right.
I am whole. I am strong. I am healed from the inside out. God, you are rejuvenating my body. As it does to say, like you said, I'm sick. This is never going to work.
Right.
It's the same amount of energy, same amount of breath.
So we have to guard ourselves not to think failure, not to think defeat, to think that we are not victorious. We have to guard our mind. And I was thinking of the, you know, when they were in the midst of trying to get into the promised land, mm-hmm. and they sent out 12 spies. I did 12. 12 spies. See, aren't you glad I taught her math? 12 spies. And 10 came back saying, we can't do this.
It's done.
It's done. It's finished. We're going to die right here. We can't defeat these guys. They are bigger than we are. Mm-hmm. And you know what? Two came back and said something different. But the 10 that came back, they were talking failure.
Yeah.
And we need to stop not only talking to it, but listening to it. Because we cannot be moved by what we hear. And you and I have to purpose in our heart to stay away from places.
Yes.
Like you said, Facebook or social media.
Sometimes it gets to you.
Oh my goodness. The news. Oh my goodness. I have deleted so many news apps on my phone because I don't want to listen to it. But I also have to stay away from people.
Yeah.
Because sometimes what they say so penetrates our heart, but we can't be around things that in any way talk us out of the blessing, Deuteronomy 28, which we taught on a while back, because eventually what they say is going to rub off on us.
Well, if you have surrounded yourself with the 10 spies, and the 10 spies might be, like you said, social media, it might be a news outlet, it might be a person that you work with, you can't just completely throw your shoulder to someone you work with, but you're surrounded by it. In those moments where you feel surrounded by it, you do have a choice with what you ingest through news and through social media and stuff like that. But maybe you're with a coworker, for example. I've shared this story before. I had a job one time and my coworker was just the complete opposite of who I was in belief system. And I would be very nice towards them, very cordial. But you know what? I'm going to just completely tune out what you're saying and listening to, and I'm going to focus in on my job, and I'm going to even potentially throw in some earbuds and listen to some worship. Because in moments like that, you have to guard your heart.
Well, remember we used to teach you, if you had a strong battery and a weak battery, and you put them together, the automatic thing you think is that the strong battery is going to make the weak battery stronger, but it's not the truth. It drains the strong battery. So you and I need to be plugged in to the power source whose name is Jesus.
Yeah.
And then we need to do something else. We need to prepare ourselves to succeed.
Yes.
So Michelle, if you'll read Joshua 1:8, because that's where we all are right now.
Yes.
It is not mind over matter.
No.
It is the word of God that has been made over matter.
Hallelujah.
So let's listen to Joshua chapter 1 verse 8.
Joshua chapter 1 and verse 8, it says, keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful.
Yes.
So again, just like Isaiah was saying, hey, you want the peace that passes all understanding? You have to get connected to Jesus. You have to stay connected in the Word of God. This is telling us the same thing. You want to be prosperous and successful? Get into the Word of God.
And
it's our job.
We were talking about it several lessons ago about painting that picture.
Even
when some blobs have appeared on your picture and you're like, ugh, I don't like this. Realize that God's making a way, but we need to picture ourselves successful.
Amen.
Victorious, healed. Because again, I'm preaching my sermon I did this morning, but we need to remember what God said.
Yes.
And we say, did the Word say that I am sick and I can never be healed? No, His Word said something differently.
Mm-hmm.
Does the Word say that I'm always going to lack and I'll never have enough? No, the Word says something else. So we need to picture ourselves walking in the favor and the success and the healing that God has for us, because it says He will make your way prosperous.
Amen.
And that you will have good success. So we can have whatever.
Hallelujah.
Whatever. The Word says it is ours.
Amen.
Because if we can see it, we can have it.
Amen. So we just right now, I just want to declare success over you.
Yes, in Jesus' name.
We declare success over your finances, yes. Success over your health, over your relationships.
Yes, yes.
We declare success over America and Canada.
In Jesus' name.
We thank
and
you,
Mexico,
Father.
God.
Yes, Lord, Father, we thank you that this world is full of Christians who are standing and believing.
Yes.
And they, because of that, they are prosperous and they are successful in every single area of their life.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
And we also declare that we are one nation under
Hallelujah.
God. That's not going to change.
Yes.
That is not in any way going to waver, because this is a nation that God has put his blessings on.
Amen.
And it's not going to change.
Hallelujah.
So, what have we learned today? Step number six, part number six, key number six, see yourself successful.
Amen.
And that you've not failed.
Amen. And that's really important for us to do every single area of our life. For generations to come, because there's moments where the enemy, he loves to bombard us.
Bombard.
He literally does a spiritual blitz of our heart to say that you are not a success, that you're a failure. And God himself looks over you and he says that you are fearfully and wonderfully made. You are the apple of his eye and you are a success.
That's
there
right.
is more for you than will ever be against you. It's 2-1. Amen.
That's right. And remember what God has said.
Amen. He loves you and we're believing God's success over you in this
Amen.
Year. And we are just so thankful that you've always tuned in to watch it.
That's right.
So much. So we'll see you next week for part 7.
I had to think, I had to count.
Love you guys.
All right, bye-bye.